Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Coming up on the program, Bryan Lynn has this week's science report on research into why methane gas is being released on the surface of Mars. Later, Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins present the lesson of the day on homophones. But first, Anna Mateo reads one of the winning entries from our Teach Us About Ukraine writing contest. Today's essay is called Berdychiv, Town of Greatness.
About 300 kilometers west, away from the crowd and the noise of the capital city of Kyiv, lies the historic and picturesque town of Berdychiv. It is a place where the sound of birds singing blends with the morning mist at sunrise. Nobody hurries here. Life goes on in Berdychiv. The town in northern Ukraine was founded in 1430. It is a place where three world cultures, Polish, Ukrainian, and Jewish, meet and are preserved. Britannica Dictionary says the town started as a Lithuanian fortress before turning into a Polish city from 1569 until 1793. At one point, it was the fourth largest city in Ukraine, with a large Jewish population. Overlooking the Hnilpiat River is the ancient monastery fortress of the Barefoot Carmelites, known as the Sanctuary of the Mother of God of the Holy Scapular. The complex was built in the 16th century by the Janusz Tyszkiewicz family. The Internet Encyclopedia of Ukraine says the complex, along with a school and publishing house, turned the city into an important Polish religious center. The complex is popular with visitors who take pictures of its magnificent buildings, and lifelong residents who take part in life ceremonies like weddings and graduations. Across the Catholic Church, in the same complex, is a museum to celebrate the life of Joseph Conrad. The English writer was born in 1857 in Berdychiv to a family of Polish patriots who fought against Russian rule. They were arrested and exiled to northern Russia, where Conrad first learned English at the age of 4. Conrad left Russia and traveled the world as a mariner before starting his writing career. Down a narrow path near the complex is an old building on the riverbanks. It is an art school where Ukrainians study to become designers, artists, and photographers. It is a place where many modern Ukrainian artists come from, and a place filled with great works of art. In the city center is an art installation, Suit from Berdychiv. Here, visitors often take pictures, eat pizza, and sit in a cafe with a view of the center. Not far from the city center is the Berdychiv Historical Museum. Founded in 1926, the museum has a collection of valuable fabrics and paintings. Berdychiv is known for one event related to the world of literature. The well-known French writer Honoré de Balzac married Eveline Hyskoff, a Polish countess, in 1850 in St. Barbara's Church, after an 18-year courtship. Some believe they chose the church for its beauty and history in a city of writers and a city of love and culture. Oleksandra Krevchenko wrote this essay. I'm Anna Mateo.
Scientists are seeking to find out what is producing the slow release of methane gas on Mars. Methane often results from biological processes. On Earth, most of the gas comes from living creatures. For this reason, the American Space Agency, NASA, has been investigating methane levels on Mars in a search for signs of current or past life. So far, no evidence has been found. But a new study is providing fresh details about methane on Mars. NASA's Curiosity Explorer, or rover, has repeatedly measured methane levels on the Martian surface. The rover arrived on Mars in 2012 and has been exploring areas around Gale Crater. This area is believed to have contained a lake at one time and has also shown other evidence of flowing water in the past. NASA says Gale Crater is the only place where methane has been discovered. Even a spacecraft sent to collect data on the Martian atmosphere has not identified the presence of methane. That spacecraft, the ExoMars Trace Gas Orbiter, is operated by the European Space Agency. In addition to only being discovered or detected around Gale Crater, the observations of methane happen only at night, NASA researchers recently reported. Levels also go up and down during different seasons and at times rise sharply for short periods. The mysterious methane releases leave scientists considering a lot of plot twists, said Curiosity Project leader Ashwin Vasavada. But a NASA research group recently proposed a possible explanation for how the gas behaves on Mars. The researchers theorize that all detected methane could be trapped or sealed underneath hardened pieces of salt in Martian regolith. Regolith describes soil that contains rock and dust that sits on or below the surface. The scientists say increases in temperature might explain the differences in gas release. During certain seasons or times of day, warmer temperatures could weaken the seal on the methane, causing gas to be released. NASA said the research was led by Alexander Pavlov, a planetary scientist at the agency's Goddard Space Flight Center in Maryland. He said small amounts of methane could also be released when the regolith seal is broken by weight from above, for example, when the Curiosity rover drives over the area. Pavlov said this theory could help explain why methane levels have only been discovered in the Gale Crater area. It is the only place on Mars where NASA's Curiosity rover is currently active. NASA has another rover working on Mars, Perseverance, but it has been exploring the Jezero crater area on another part of the planet. Jezero crater is also believed to have contained large water bodies in the distant past. But Perseverance is not equipped with a methane detecting instrument. Pavlov noted that the latest theory came from his memories of an unrelated experiment carried out in 2017. The experiment involved growing microorganisms in a simulated Martian environment that included frozen soil that contained salt. During that experiment, researchers observed that the collection of soil on top formed an icy, salty crust. Changes in conditions caused the ice to melt, turning the solid material into a gas and leaving the salt behind. Pavlov's team tested 5 samples of frozen soil containing different kinds of salt material commonly found on Mars. A new set of Earth-based experiments was carried out in which the frozen material was exposed to different temperatures and air pressures inside an environment at Goddard that was designed to be like Mars. The team was able to repeatedly copy the salt sealing process in Mars-like conditions during laboratory testing. The researchers said they plan to keep carrying out experiments under different conditions and using salt minerals to confirm their theory. But the researchers noted that to carry out more detailed methane investigations, they will likely need a whole new generation of sensitive instruments. These would be designed to measure methane continuously from many places on Mars. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn is back with me now to talk more about today's science report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Of course, Dan. Glad to be here.
This week's report dealt with new research on the release of methane gas on the Martian surface. This is not the first time we've heard about methane being observed on Mars. Why are the researchers so interested in studying this particular gas?
So the reason they're so focused on methane is they believe its presence on Mars may lead to new evidence of life. And this is currently NASA's main science goal there, to explore the possibility that some form of life exists on Mars or might have existed in the past. Scientists have noted, for example, that many biological processes come from methane, and most of this gas found on Earth comes from living things. But it is also important to point out that so far, no direct evidence of such life on Mars has been found.
The researchers seemed persuaded they might have found an explanation for what they described as a mysterious release of methane on Mars. Where will their research go from here?
So the main thing the scientists said they would center on is continuing to carry out experiments to confirm their latest results. This will involve similar testing, but they'll be trying to change the substance mixtures, they said, to try to include more specifically known minerals and salts found on Mars. One thing that was noted, however, is the team said more exact methane measurements would require additional equipment and instruments being sent to Mars. And this kind of deployment will, of course, not happen anytime soon.
Very interesting. Thanks again for joining me, Bryan.
You're welcome. Thank you, Dan.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
What do those two sounds you heard have in common? Today's lesson is about some fun and, we hope, interesting ways English connects words, spelling, and sounds.
Or maybe about the ways their spellings don't seem to connect to sounds, since English spelling can be difficult. But don't worry, this is not going to be a spelling lesson. Think of it more like a sound lesson.
We'll have more to say about that phrase, a sound lesson, a little later. But now let's join Anna in lesson 26 of the series. As we explained in another podcast lesson, Anna is playing a game on her phone. It's a scavenger hunt where she tries to learn more about U.S. history. Let's join her.
When you find an American symbol, you win points and a fun fact about a U.S. president.
Yay! I found Uncle Sam, and I won 40 points. What is the fun fact?
Franklin Roosevelt was the first to fly in a plane as president.
I didn't know that. This is a really beautiful memorial. This is the Lincoln Memorial. Where is the symbol? I found it, the Statue of Liberty. Please give me my fun fact.
Abraham Lincoln was a great wrestler.
I didn't know that. Lincoln wanted freedom for all people. So the Statue of Liberty works well. And I won 20 points. Time to find the next symbol.
You heard the word symbol three times in that exchange.
When you find an American symbol, you win points and a fun fact about a U.S. president.
This is the Lincoln Memorial. Where is the symbol? And I won 20 points. Time to find the next symbol.
A symbol is a shape, object, sign, in short, any visual thing that represents an idea.
We use symbols all the time, such as the plus sign in mathematics to represent addition. And we use symbols to represent many, many kinds of ideas.
In the scavenger hunt game, Anna and Dan are looking for a very important symbol in American history and culture. It's so important that it's worth 100 points in their game. Here's Dan and Anna in lesson 25 of the series.
What symbol are you looking for now?
I am looking for the bald eagle. That is 100 points. It should be near the Washington Monument.
Ah, yes. The bald eagle. It is a large bird that hunts small animals and fish. When it is older, the feathers on its head turn white. That's why they call it bald, which means having no hair on your head.
Oh, like me.
Yeah, kind of. But let's not digress or move away from the main idea of our lesson. Many Americans see the bald eagle as symbolizing freedom and strength.
Symbolize is the verb form of the noun symbol, and symbolic is the adjective. And that sound you heard earlier? Well, that's the sound a bald eagle makes.
But what about that other sound?
That's the sound of a symbol.
Hey, wait, are you trying to confuse our listeners?
Haha, a little bit. But here's the idea. The bald eagle is a symbol. That's spelled S-Y-M-B-O-L. But there is also an object used in music called a symbol. That's spelled C-Y-M-B-A-L.
Two words that make exactly the same sound in English are called homophones. And there are many of them. Here are a few examples. Cell, spelled C-E-L-L, like the cells in your body, or like a cell phone, and sell, S-E-L-L. That means to take money for something.
And we have flower, spelled F-L-O-U-R, which we use for making bread, and flower, F-L-O-W-E-R, the colorful blooms on plants such as a rose, daisy, or sunflower. Jill, why do you think English has so many homophones?
It's because English developed as a combination of different languages. As a result, it mixed the spelling system of the languages, which is why we have several ways of spelling the same sound.
That makes it interesting, but also difficult for people learning English.
That's true. There are spelling rules for English that a learner can follow, but there are also a lot of words that break the rules.
And, of course, many English words have letters that are not pronounced at all. We call these silent letters.
And now, the silent letters.
Actually, we're going to talk about only one silent letter today. But let's get there by listening to Anna in Lesson 26 of the Let's Learn English series.
When you find an American symbol, you win points and a fun fact about a U.S. president.
Yay! I found Uncle Sam, and I won 40 points. What is the fun fact?
Franklin Roosevelt was the first to fly in a plane as president.
I didn't know that. This is a really beautiful memorial. This is the Lincoln Memorial. Where is the symbol? I found it, the Statue of Liberty. Please give me my fun fact.
Abraham Lincoln was a great wrestler.
And how do we spell that last word you just heard? Wrestler? It sounds like the letter R.
The word has the letter R, but it has a silent letter before it. Listeners, what letter do you think that is?
Here's a hint. You can write someone an email. How do you spell that verb I just said? The verb write.
That's right. That's correct. You spell it W-R-I-T-E. And wrestler is spelled W-R-E-S-T-L-E-R.
Wrestling is a sport where you try to hold your opponent onto the ground.
Here are three pairs of words that are homophones, and where one of the words in each pair begins with the silent W. When you hear each pair, see if you can think of the two words that match the sound but are spelled differently. Ready? Listen.
Right.
Right.
Rest.
Rest.
Wrote.
Wrote.
You already know what it means to write your name, but write, R-I-T-E, means a traditional or religious ceremony.
You know what it means to rest when you are tired, but rest, W-R-E-S-T, means to grab something or take something from somebody else, often with some difficulty.
Yesterday, Jill wrote her name, but wrote, R-O-T-E, is doing or learning something just by repeating it over and over without thinking much or understanding much about it. We usually put the preposition by before the noun wrote.
Right. And that's R-I-G-H-T. For example, we can say the student studied only by rote.
There's the sound of that American symbol again, which brings us back to the phrase, a sound lesson. The word sound is most commonly used as a noun, but we can also use the word as an adjective with a different meaning.
If something is sound, that means it is done correctly. The adjective sound can also describe a building or structure that is strong and without important defects.
So, we hope this lesson of the day has been a sound lesson for you.
And since we've talked a lot about sounds, if we use the noun, we can call today's lesson a lesson in sound.
Now, let's see if Anna and Dan found the bald eagle. Let's listen to more of Lesson 26.
This game is a lot of fun. What's your name?
Dan. What's yours?
Anna.
Like Americana.
Yeah, I guess so.
Did you find any symbols?
Yes, I found three, and I won 120 points.
Me too, but did you find the bald eagle?
No. Did you?
No.
First one to find it wins.
Hey, Anna, look out for that tree.
I learned a lot about presidents with this game, but I ought to be more careful. Till next time.
Until next time means it's also time for us to go. Keep listening and reading for homophones in English.
And remember that you can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram.
Thanks for listening to the Learning English Podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.